Tell me a little bit about yourself and your history as a violinist.
I was five. I started playing the Suzuki violin method, which is, you know, kind of famous at this point, but it's basically a method that emphasizes starting young, learning by ear, and parental involvement, you know, the nurturing of music or nurturing through music. So I had a classical background, and when I was about 14 or 15, I was a very serious classical violinist at that time, but I got interested in rock music and stuff like that. That's what my friends were doing. You know, they were all picking up guitars and drums and basses, and so I started picking up guitars, and then that kind of led me to want to play, you know, the violin in rock music. And then after that, you know, I got interested in blues and gospel music, R&B, and then eventually jazz.
Well, I find you to be, in my personal opinion, the best jazz violinist that I've heard. Tell me a little bit about how you developed your mainstream jazz conception.
I think there's a couple answers to that question. Number one, I really looked outside the instrument, outside of the violin. I looked to singers, I looked to guitar players, saxophone players, piano players, to really get to the heart of the music. You know, as people say, go to the source. And even beyond that, I tried to look to like the cultural source, frankly, of the music, the historic and cultural source. There was, you know, a time in my life when I really started getting into jazz. I was actually playing in African-American gospel church services. And I think that was one of the things that really inspired me to learn, to go deeper into trying to learn about the blues. I think the fact that I'm into many different, I'm a broad, eclectic kind of guy. So I didn't just focus on only bebop or only old time swing. You know, I kind of have dabbled in a lot of different things and tried to bring those all together.
Tell me a little bit about your impressions of the musicians and how the session, developed.
The musicians were incredible. I mean, Roger Calloway is, what an amazing cat, you know. I mean, he played with Joni Mitchell in like the 60s or the 70s. I mean, that floored me when I heard about that. And all the other people, all the other things that he's done, and he worked with Nadja Solanas Sollenberg, and he does all these, you know, so many things. Roger was amazing to work with. Nate, who works with the Peabodys, which is a... Nate Wood, yeah, who works with the Peabodys. Very modern, conceptual drummer, and very young kind of energy. And he fit right into this thing with Roger, you know, who's in a totally different generation. I love that tension between those two guys and seeing that happen in the studio. Bob Magnuson played the bass, and he just had a beautiful energy. You know, Roger's worked with Bob for years, and Bob was just kind of the go-to guy. He was always ready to just be the glue of the session. Andreas Oberg, of course, another featured artist of Resonance Records, from Sweden. We hung out, met him actually at your place here, and we went and worked out in the gym a couple days. He kind of inspired me to get back on track with the gym thing, because he's a little younger than me, and he's got that fire, so it was great to hang out with Andreas. And he's a burning guitar player. What else can be said? I mean, just listen to his record. He's like one of the totally burning guitar player, one of the most happening, burning young players on the scene.
How about the arrangements that were done for you, the orchestral arrangements?
Yeah, well, that was a really nice thing to have actual orchestral arrangements. Kuno Schmid is a guy in Germany that I met. He came to L.A. one time, and you introduced me to him, and he does these beautiful arrangements, and I was just tickled that I could have these arrangements be a part of this record. Kuno uses this, I guess you could almost call it, orchestra simulation technology. It's basically like, if you think about the way a lot of albums are produced, people use keyboards, they use samples, and a lot of pop music today and a lot of jazz music today, we think of production as the layering of these different sonic textures using technology such as samplers, such as, you know, but you don't necessarily think of doing that with this kind of classical sonic palette, if you will, like an orchestral sonic palette. But in the case of this album, I think it's very interesting that Kuno is not only a great arranger, but he's able to manipulate the technology, the sampling technology, to create these orchestral colors. The arrangements on all of these tunes in the record were really, I don't know how to say it exactly, very, maybe this isn't the most eloquent thing way to say it, but they're very classy. I think they're very, you know, they all have this kind of orchestral, almost classical element at times, which I think comes from Roger, again, Roger's ability to exist in both worlds. He crosses over between being like a great classical musician and also a great jazz musician. And so this really appeals to me, and I think that it's rare that I'm able to find musicians that can speak in both those languages for me, but in a jazz-centered way. So this is the first time that I've ever worked with a true producer, i.e., namely you, George Klabin. And I have to say, it was arduous, it was challenging at times, but now, at the end of the game, I have to say, thank you, George. You really helped get something out of me that otherwise I don't think I ever would have created.
Chris, thank you so much for your time, and we're looking forward to a long and fruitful relationship with you, and as both personally and musically.
Me too. Thanks, George.